So what I'd like to do now is to present this present during this lecture some of the examples of the techniques and technologies that we use, people involved in agroecology would use to better intensify the work on the land in a more ecological basis. So it's still a very exceptional a way of doing farming in Brazil, exceptional in a way that it's the minority of the cases that you see in Brazil. People that have this ecological basis would be very few people. So, but still, I think it's we're not talking about the amount, we're talking about the symbol, to give the example, to let people know that you can do something in a different way of the general idea, the predominant idea of the paradigm that say, oh, if you don't do this, there is no way of working on this land. For example, using heavy machinery or chemicals, you know. So basically, we're going to be talking about a few techniques of food production, both based on ecological tools. And I would like to play during this time a little movie for you, a documentary about agroforestry, which is one of the techniques people in agroecology are using to take advantage of the laws of nature, the way the cycles of nature, to produce food inside a forest. So whenever you hear the expression agroforest, means a forest that also produces food. Can produce other things like wood, but mostly food, right? So yeah, I just told you that in the previous lectures that cattle in Brazil specifically, and I believe that in other places as well, has played a very contradictory role. At the same time, that's people are going to buy beef, so you need to have cattle production. And cattle can improve or destroy the environment depending on how you conduct your cattle, your beef production or your milk production. One of the ways that I think we can take advantage of going back to the past, going back to the work of millennia of farmers, the work that farmers has been produced through the millennia on the animal selection, for example, is to take advantage of the amazing genetic basis that we can use to produce food in a more indigenous way. Indigenous in the sense that you're not ignoring your local conditions. If my weather is tropical, I shouldn't be using an animal that was selected for a temperate, cold climate, for example. And this is one of the examples I particularly always try to put forward. This is a cross bred between the Holstein species, that one that produced, you know, the black and yellow cow. That's the Holstein. That's the typical cow image that comes to our mind when we talk about milk. So this is a mixed bread between that bread and the Indian bread, a bread from India called Gir, the curved horns I showed you in the previous lecture. So this result is an animal that takes advantage of all the qualities each bread has. So it's resistant to the weather, to the sunlight, for example, and it's able to convert poor vegetation into milk and meat, and it's always also very resistant to parasites and other disease, very common in tropical pastures. And at the same time, as you can evaluate from the size of the udder, it's going to be able to produce a fairly amount of milk, which is going to be the cheapest milk you can produce on the tropics, because you're not going to be spending a lot of money artificializing your system in order to attend the high demands of a highly productive Holstein cow, for example. So this is the kind of indigenous technologies that are available for us. And actually, these girls here are my cows. They're not all here. There are six more, I guess, behind. I have a total 18. And they are all the result of this cross that you can make between a very productive and a very resistant, I like to say efficient, bread that you can put together and explore, intensify your production. But this is only one way to intensify your production. So if we can just imagine that if you have a limited area that you can you intend to use for milk production, for example, maybe milk is not enough, the milk that's going to produce is not enough to sustain that family, to keep that family economically healthy. So maybe a better idea, instead of only producing milk, maybe it's going to be produce milk and maybe some wool and maybe some meat as well. So in that sense, we can always intensify the way you're using the same area, adding species that complement each other in terms of what they eat. This is one, I think it's a very nice example of how you can combine like different species, both herbivores, animals that eat plants, to increase the production of the very same area that you have available to produce food. So as the sheep and goats eat different parts of vegetation, sometimes vegetation that cows wouldn't eat, they just complement each other, they're not competing with each other. Probably there is some competition, there's always some competition in nature, that's not necessarily bad, but there's a lot of cooperation here as well. For example, if you add a species into the same area that you're going to explore the pastures, sometimes one species block the disease cycles that would be affecting the other species. So this is the kind of complementarity we expect when we add diversity in the system. And we should be thinking about adding diversity to the systems. I guess the worst kind of monoculture, you know, just cultivate one thing, idea in agriculture, is the monoculture of mind. If we think that we only can produce in a certain way or using a certain number of species, I think we're always going to be facing more problems than solutions, because this is not sustainable. This is not a tenet of nature. Nature relies on diversity, interaction. So if you can both diversify the species that we are using to eat the pastures, but we also can diversify the species that compose, that make our pastures even better. Because some plants, like the cloves, they're very rich on protein. But some other plants, like the grass, many kinds of grass, they have a lot of energy, fibers, but they're not always rich on proteins. So when you combine them, you have like the perfect meal. It's like every mom would be concerned about this with their kids, right? They'd be saying, oh, you need to eat salad, but also meat and rice. So they're always trying to make the kids' diet the more complete as they, you know, nutritionally rich as they can. So we should be thinking about the same ideas of using nature tenets like diversity to intensify production. There is one specific resource in nature that is very important for us. We once in a while talking about this along our different conversations, which is water. And water is becoming a very difficult resource to get. I don't know if all of you have this picture in your mind, but the available water, meaning fresh water for us, it's very limited. Most of our planet is composed of water, but that's salty water, right? From the fresh water that we have, let's say 3%, less than 1% is available for us, because most of it is in the form of ice, and some of them we cannot reach for different reasons, because sometimes they are underground. So water is a very limited resource for us, and we should be thinking about how we can maximize the amount of water that we harvest and the amount of water we can recycle in order to keep a sustainable living in this planet, right? So what I'm going to do from now on is introducing some of the technologies that they don't look technology. When you think about technology, you always think about microchips and machines and all these fancy things. But I, in my opinion, actually, we should be thinking more about this kind of technology if you want to resolve the very same problems that the peasants, for example, face in their very limited resource basis farms. So this is one thing, that this is one kind of technology that we are trying to push forward in Brazil, in some rural areas. And there are actually two kinds of technologies here. One is the green ceiling, you know, the green ceiling, because we Brazil can be very hot in some regions, most of the regions, at least some time of the year is going to be really hot, and that would reduce the amount of the heat that the interior of the house receives, like during those that time of the year. Plus, is also a good measure to reduce the amount of calories we irradiate back to the atmosphere. So we think in a small scale. We're thinking about to make the lives of people that live inside this house more comfortable, in terms of heat. But we're also thinking about the big picture. If we just imagine a whole city with this kind of ceilings, we would be thinking in a cool city, in a more refreshing place to live. And that's because the atmosphere is receiving less radiation of the sunlight that hits these ceilings, right? But the important thing here that we promote this kind of technology to improve people's life is that you can collect the excess of water that falls on this very limited area. And people are now getting so excited about this that they are even creating artificial collecting water areas connected to little plastic barrels where they can gather as much water as they can. So they get it's. I usually see this as a addiction. Once you collect 1,000 liters, you want to collect 10,000. And once you collect 10,000, you want to increase to 100,000. And that keeps growing. So basically, all the water collected from the ceiling is going to pass through a series of different devices people use to filter the first rains, because those are the ones that are going to clean the ceiling. And after that water can be accumulated in a kind of reservoir to be used along the year by people that live in this kind of house. This can be done in several scales. You can do this just to sustain people during the time water is scarce, you don't have rains, like in the dry season. Or you can construct such a reservoir that you can accumulate water to use during the whole year. Some people are even using similar devices to collect runoff water from the roads that they can accumulate in huge reservoirs and can be used for agriculture and for animal drinking. So it's the kind of technology is getting really becoming common in Brazil, not because people are getting more mindful, conscious about our crisis, but because we are living in very difficult times, including for even thinking about the resources that are so basic for life, like water. So that's what's driving people to embrace this kind of technology. And that can be done in every scale that you imagine. It can be done in a more sophisticated way like this, that it would involve some building, you know, using cement and iron and all the materials that we need to build a reservoir, or can just be used to store in these barrels, these plastic barrels, which are becoming very common in Brazil in the last 20 years. The only thing people should be caring about, but I'm not sure if all of them are, is that these barrels should be food graded. They should be used in the past, in their first use, to carry food or at least non-toxic material. So you can store water and know that water is safe for drinking or for general human use. And that's becoming very popular in Brazil right now. So at the same time, we stimulate people to do this kind of technology. We also pressing for the government to make some funding, public funding, public policies available for the peasants, so they can adapt this kind of technology to their reality. It's kind of bright here, but this is a typical small family farm in Northeast Brazil, and I can tell that's Northeast Brazil because this kind of thorn cacti, this vegetation, is very typical from the dry areas in Brazil. The houses are always very simple houses, but you can see here that people are already collecting water, because in the Northeast Brazil have only 3 months with very abundant rain. It can rain like almost 100 or 200 millimeters in one rainfall. And sometimes the whole week will be raining this amount of rain, but the rest of the 9 months in the year may not have any rainfall at all. So people are very concerned about conserving water in this kind of environment. They do that in different ways. This is one of them. This is the kind of reservoir subsidized by the government. There is a project called A Million Reservoir in Brazil, put forward by a NGO called ASA, which is the Assistance for the Semi-Arid, I guess. I don't remember correctly what the sigil means, but the basic idea is to build a million of these cisterns, reservoirs. The portion is, you guys see, like above ground, has the same amount of volume like below ground, like in the subterranean. So you can have the typical one would hold for 64 to 70 thousand liters, and that's considered enough to keep the family basic needs during the dry season, during 9 months. Sometimes it's less than this. They're always grateful when it's less than this, but it can be 9 months, right? So this is the kind of technology we are trying to make more and more common. This is one way to preserve water, and this is another way to preserve water. This is the kind of plant, this is the kind of adequate and proper technology genetic technology that we should be using to preserve water in a biological way, because it's this plant may be not rich in terms of protein, but when the cattle or the goats or the sheep feel thirsty, they can have their needs satisfied just eating this kind of material after you cut. So now the extension and research agricultural agencies in Brazil, they are trying to improve this species of cacti so it doesn't have the thorns, the spines, so the cattle can, the farmers can provide this to the cattle without a lot of work removing the thorns. So the combination of several kinds of technologies, I think, are going to improve the lives of many people. Only this simple initiative in Brazil has reduced the infant mortality in less than more than 50% in Northeast Brazil, because this is not only water to meet the needs of the family that lives in that house, but also is a water that's very sealed. It's not animals and disease has no access to this. So that prevents a lot of disease that would in the past 20 years kill the kids that are younger than 2 years old. So, you know, they are very simple technologies, but they can be very significant. And we're just talking about this kind of technology during lunch. I particularly feel very guilty whenever I flush my toilet, and I know that I'm using drinkable water, because it's such a waste of a very precious resource. And every time I do that, I remember the many people in the world that had no access to water whatsoever. So I showed you two pictures in my talk in the science unit, showing an old lady that goes very early morning to collect water in a pond, a little pond in Northeast Brazil. And she needs to go really early there, because otherwise the animals, like the cattle, will come there and will make the water inappropriate for drinking. So that's the kind of people I have in my mind when I flush the toilet with the drinkable water. So I think we should be concerned about this and thinking on different technologies that can be used to recycle water. For example, you could be using the water of many people have different devices at their places that wash their dishes or their clothes or even the shower place. So that all that water could be used to flush the toilet. Why not? We have the technology already to do that. It's just not the kind of technology that increase the profits of the big companies. So we should be taking action by ourselves, not expecting that the government is going to put this forward, because the government is concerned about the needs of the big companies, not about our needs. So that's the kind of this is not my area. It's not my. I have no skills in engineering, but I know that many people in Brazil are now doing this. Mostly people that have conscience and money enough to change their plumbing, and put some pumps like this, so they can redirect water to distribute on the lavatories, and you know. But I'm guessing that the more people use this kind of technology, the cheaper the technology becomes. It becomes more common, and that's what we should be pursuing. In a last step, I think we should be thinking about dry toilets, right? The toilets that you use. The alchemy of carbon and nitrogen instead of water to get rid of the human residues. So I think that's another idea that we could be thinking about. Well, the kind of technology I'm more familiar with is this collection of water from any surface that receives direct rainfall to be used in agriculture, in small scale agriculally. We generally thinking about, every time we go to a small farm and talk to the family, we want to know, so how many people is living in are living in this place, and how much you guys eat of vegetables, for example, along a week. So that give us the proper numbers we can use to start to make projections, like how much food we need to produce along the year. And then we think about, okay, we are situated in a place that doesn't have, that has a lot of rainfall, like the coast of Brazil. And during parts of the year, we were discussing this with Chao yesterday, some plants don't like strong rainfall, like lettuce, for example. What should we be doing in order to make lettuce production available and feasible along the year? So there are very simple structures that you can build. This is not the simplest one. The simplest one would be, for example, use bamboo. And we are now developing several kind of shelters for protected production during the rain season. And it's very cheap, very easy to build. You can involve the whole community on building several of these structures along different people's farms, so they can always have the open area where the food is produced along the dry season, but also the a covered area, protected area, in which the food is produced during the wet season, if some plants are sensitive to big amounts of water. And why not use this the very same structures to also collect water? So you can just make this loop in the system. You just recycle the whole system. We had this general tenet in permaculture that you should be using one same structure for different functions. That's a way to improve the use of a resource, like when you multifunction a structure. So that's the kind of simple but very efficient technologies we had in mind. But that's a very small scale kind of production. Now I plan to move to a larger scale kind of productive system. This is a representation of the different vegetables that you can be producing in a agroforestry system. So you have here the vegetables being produced, like lettuce, arugula, tomatoes. You have corn, you have some coffee, probably, banana, and then you have papaya. You have like, the coffee is here. This is something else, it's probably orange. So you have the traditional fruits from whatever region you are. This is acai. I don't know if you guys are familiar with this. It's a palm tree that produces some little coconut. And the soft part of this coconut, which is very, it's a violet color, produce a juice that's very appreciated by the athletes because it's very energetic. Japan is a big importer of Brazilian acai, and US is becoming very big fan of acai as well. But then you can always have the trees that would serve you as timber. You know, I have no problem with cutting trees. As long as if you cut one, you plant three trees. Three is not a good number to use in this example, but you could do in a sustainable way. And I think that's the big challenge to convince people. I'm always struggling with my biology colleagues because they have this idea of prevent people to be inside nature. And I have a totally different idea. I think people should be inside nature so they can care, like, and understand nature. That's the only way I think it's feasible for us to save anything. Because if you just remove people from nature, that's just idyllic. That's just appreciation. That's not the connection that we should be having with the natural systems. That's my general idea. And this kind of forest producing food was mostly promoted in Brazil by this man. This is a Swiss man called Ernest Goetsch. He's living in Brazil for more than 40 years now, probably more than that. He is living in the southern part of my state, Bahia, where I was born. The southern part of Bahia was first region where the Portuguese arrived. They destroyed most of the forest to remove pau-brasil. After that, they start planting several different crops. Nowadays, meaning from the 50s on, or even before, they start to plant cacao. The region where he lives is the major region that produces cacao in Brazil, the southern part of Bahia. Probably some chocolate that you guys have part comes from this part of the room. But when he arrived there and he's talking inside his property right now, this place was just bare land, a place that has been all deforested, all destroyed, and had many, in the past, had many springs, natural springs. But when he bought that piece of land, all those springs are extinct, they're gone. And the local people said, oh, this guy is probably paying that amount of money for that land because he's crazy. He's a gringo. He's a foreign. He knows nothing about land. That's why he's buying this very poor and degraded land. And in at least 30 years of work, he transformed that piece of land in the most productive and luxurious Atlantic rainforest back. He's harvesting cacao as well as a huge amount of other fruits, native or not. He's doing timber. He's doing a lot of activities lately, courses on agroforestry as well, on his techniques to promote the sustainable use of forests. And every image from satellites now shows that the piece of land that he owns, I think is above 200 hectares that he owns in this part of Bahia. All images from the satellites indicate that that's the most productive forest you have in the whole southern of Bahia. So that's amazing because against all the odds, he just turned. And a good result of his efforts in this part of Bahia was that many of the springs that were gone, now he resurrected all these springs. So he's one of the most valuable land now in southern Bahia because it had a lot of water being produced there and benefiting a lot of people surrounding this area. So everyone wants to know who is the crazy Swiss guy that's doing this, all this revolution there. He developed this technique in agroforestry. He didn't create the agroforestry technology. He learned part of this in Costa Rica before moving to Brazil. But he has improved this technology and gave it a name that's kind of weird name, is syntropic agriculture, which I'm not going to try to explain here, but he used several techniques to agroforestry. One of them, and he's always very modest about, is he said that we need to go back in our first week if we want to produce you're gonna arrive in a place and you want to plant your own agroforestry. So you should go there in the first week, travel to a preserved forest from the same region, sit there during a week, and just look how the patterns happen in nature. What's going on there? What are the principles that sustain that forest in their pristine way? So one of the tenets is that every forest that you go, if it's a preserved forest, gonna have this the soil covered, right? So you always have this inside the forest, the leaves that fall, the barks, and all the material that are being transformed in organic material is covering the soil. And the good of this, one of the goods of this, is that this layer of organic material is both serving as the fertilizer that soil needs, meaning the forest is fertilizing itself, its own soil, and also protecting this team of billions of microorganisms that live below that layer, and it's responsible for keeping the fertile soil fertile, and even more fertile throughout the years, right? So it's protecting the microorganisms of the soil. So he said that if you cannot keep your soil covered, you're missing a major lesson that nature can give us, or specifically the forest can give us, which is a covered soil. And that's more or less what we are looking for, we're trying to achieve. And I was very happy to see that Chow's plots were all, he's doing a good job in trying to cover all of them. And I could notice yesterday the difference between the land he is managing compared to the lands I walked through along. They're not being ecologically managed, because it's the same in Brazil. People had an idea that if you're going to plant something, the soil needs to be clean. But clean doesn't mean plastic. The plastic or the garbage is going to be removed. It's like everything, bare soil. That's the general idea of a clean soil. And for us, when we start to understand this ecological principles of nature, this is the clean soil. This is as clean as you can be, like, because it's covered. It's probably supporting a huge amount of microorganism activity inside here that's going to give the rewards for the plants that you're gonna introduce to this area. So that's the one general idea. Keep your soil covered. That's also a way to protect the soil against erosion. I always, when I had the chance, I take my students. We make a circle, everyone very close together, and I ask someone to take some water and just pour in a bare soil. And what that's gonna do is, like, the water is gonna splash in the soil and splash mud in everyone's legs, and the people screaming, and they said, "Oh yeah, that's the action of erosion. That's what the rainfall is gonna do to your soil if your soil is not protected." Then we do the same circle after everyone's clean already. We do the same circle in a place like this, covered, and pour the water, and no water splashed on people's legs. So it's a very simple way to make them understand what the advantages of have a covered soil. So this is one of the principles. The second principle, which is also an ecological principle, would be the succession of species, both in space and time. So, I'm sorry if it's not translated, some parts are not translated to Portuguese. This is just saying the natural succession in an agroforest. So, what we're talking about here is, like, if you take a piece of forest and cut this piece of one part of this forest and observe what's going to happen, you're going to see that in the first years, the very basic vegetation is going to develop there. So you don't need to plant anything. During the millions of years that forest was there, it just accumulates on the soil the amount of seeds that all these trees produced along millions of years, right? So this is basically a bank, a seed bank. There are many seeds here. Seeds from this time when this forest was really young, seeds from this time during the which the forest was teenage, and seeds from this time when the forest was kind of old forest. So if you cut a piece of this forest along the first months, for example, it's going to produce, it's going to try to come back with very simple, basic vegetation. And these are the very species that are going to start to prepare this soil for later years. The soil is fertile enough and structured enough to receive a more demanding kind of vegetation. Plants that are going to require more fertilization and more structured soil with more water, for example. So we should expect that during this time, during the first weeks or months, you're going to see a lot of bacteria and fungi, for example, and later on some grass. Have you guys ever paid attention that in the open areas of in the border of the forest, you see grass, you see some ferns? These are the plants that they don't require much of resources, but they can fulfill their mission during that time of they remain there. They will cover the soil. They start to grow, produce some shade. They're gonna lose some leaves. Those leaves are gonna be start to incorporate in the soil. The microorganisms start to work, eat these leaves, release the minerals. So this soil is becoming more and more rich. So later on, when the conditions are met, more requiring plants can get established there. So you try to grow, and if the soil is ready, they will grow. And those are going to be the shrubs, like the a little taller vegetation, but already more complex. So the diversity of species there is start to increase, not only the structure of the forest, but also the number of species start to increase, right? That means that more material are going to be produced by this species and be progressively accumulating in the soil. And you keep going with observing these patterns, and until the moment that the big trees, the ones that use the seeds. So I don't know what the background, the farming background that you guys have, but I'm going to explain this very in a very simple way. A seed of a Brazilian nut would require a soil with a certain amount of fertility and humidity, right? So these conditions are not here. Maybe they are not here yet, but when the forest is old enough, that seed would feel that. It's alive, it's in the soil. And it's, after it feels it, that this stimuli in terms of fertility and shade conditions and moist conditions is going to start to germinate. It may take 10 years until it reach the point that it's going to produce its own fruits and seeds, but it's only going to germinate if the right, the proper conditions is there. So that's the general idea. So in time and also in space, species succeed each other in nature in order to go back to the become a forest again, go back to the prime state, right? Becoming progressively taller, progressively more diverse, and progressively more suitable environment for more requiring species. That's the general idea of how we should be mimicking nature if you want to produce food inside a forest, right? So the guys, the people involved on this, they realized that they could be doing this, and this is one way they are producing this food forests in Brazil. So first they take down some of the old plantations that they have there. And as this whole area, this whole region was originally a forest, probably the seeds are still there. Maybe they need to introduce some native species that are not there anymore because some mechanization may have removed those seeds from there. But in general, you always have a healthy bank of seeds, whenever you had a forest in the past. So they're going to take down a piece of land where they can change for a banana plantation, for example, to a more diverse food forest. They're going to make limes. So this is the lime they do. This material here, these pieces of wood, are the result of these banana trees that they cut. And they cut in little pieces, organize them like this, and plant along this trail here whatever they want to plant. But if this is an open area now, what should be they planting there? What are the species they should be planting in this very open environment? What do you guys think? What are the kinds of food they're going to plant there right now, in the beginning? Which kind of food we know that we can plant in the open environment and we can produce a lot? Chow is planting a lot of them, actually. Potatoes, manioc, lettuce, arugula, corn, right? These are the kind of food that goes very well in open environments. You cannot shade them much. So they're taking advantage of this open area, a lot of sunlight going there, and they're gonna plant all these vegetables. But the secret is they're not gonna plant only the vegetables there. They're gonna plant also the whole consortium, the whole mix of species they want to be there in the future. And that's the tricky thing. That's one thing that Ernest Goetsch, the Swiss guy, incorporated in the concept of the agroforestry. You don't need to wait till the soil is ready to plant the seeds of the native trees or the fruit trees. You can plant them together with the vegetables in an organized way. Or, for example, the fruit trees, orange, you're going to plant them 5 meters from each other. But in the middle of this, couple orange trees, you're planting vegetables like lettuce, carrot, arugula, beet. While this environment is still not shaded by these trees because they're gonna take like 3 years, 2 years and a half to grow, you planting over and harvesting over and over the vegetables. So that's a way you can intensify the use of the same piece of land to plant whatever you want that to be in the future, but also profit from the vegetables you can be selling or using for your family, and then they exceed, you're just gonna sell to other people. So that in after about 2 years, that plant, that piece of land is already paid because the money that you produced planting vegetables. After a while, you'll be harvesting vegetables plus the fruit, like the nona tree here, or maybe the guandu. This is the manioc. This is not for eating. This is a kind of green manure, mucuna, anan. So it's also a way for you to improve the soil. You can plant some green manure, plants that would fix nitrogen from the atmosphere and incorporate in the soil. Nitrogen is a very important fertilizer for the plants. So you're doing ecologically, you're fertilizing your soil at the same time you're eating the products of that soil as well, or selling this produce. So after some years, this is the result that you have. So you have some taro here, you have some lettuce. Maybe somewhere you're gonna have some fruit trees. This is another way to intensify your very limited area. Combine things that help each other. Some plants are called the companion plants. They're always gonna help each other. One, maybe preventing bugs to go there and cause some damage. Maybe some are going to improve the soil fertility. So they help each other and help you as well, because instead of only harvesting lettuce, you're going to harvest lettuce and taro and maybe something else. So you intensify the use of space, right? So that's how people are doing. This is a general way people are using agroforestry in Brazil. So we have some banana tree here. So when you look the system in that stage, you already know that one of the goals of the farmer is to have fruit trees there. Not now, they're not going to collect anything from now, but in the future they're going to be able to collect both the fruits and the vegetables. Once the fruits grow, the fruit species grow, they start to shade the area like this. There is more shade here now because the fruits and the native trees, they are creating these shaded areas. So maybe that's not, that environment may not be feasible for you to keep planting vegetables. So then you have two options, and that's another input of Ernest in the agroforest system. You can prune parts of the fruit trees, like prune the branches, because they will regrow. And you incorporate these branches on the soil, and that will be your fertilizers, right? Your natural fertilizers. Bananas, banana trees are amazing for that purpose, for several reasons. One of them is that, I don't know if you all know, but a banana tree is going to produce one set. In Brazil, some of them are going to produce two or three, and that's amazing. But most of the varieties are going to produce one set of banana. I don't know how to call this in English, but it's going to produce a banana and it's not going to produce anything more. But other banana trees are coming, the daughter and then the granddaughter are coming, and they are going to be able to produce. But the grandma banana tree can be put down, cut, and become fertilization, like the fertilizer of the soil. And that's the way you can pump a lot of fertilizer in your soil. You can add more and more fertility to your soil without buying any chemical fertilizer. It takes time, but it's rewarding. In the end, it's a system that accumulates soil quality instead of losing soil quality, as it happens in the conventional agriculture. So this pruning, intensive pruning and adding carbon material into the soil is also a technique that Ernst Goetsch put forward in the syntropic agriculture to accelerate the system, to make the system produce more and faster, right? Because in the past, people were just leaving the forest grow. After the forest grow, you don't plant vegetables anymore, and you're just going to collect fruits or timber, but allow you're not adding anything in the soil. You allowing the nature do that, like with the shading leaves or barks, and that was improvement of the system. What I want to do now is to show you a little. It's a very short documentary about how people are doing agroforestry in Brazil, and actually in a place that's not a forest, but is in the Brazilian Cerrado, the Brazilian similar environment to the savanna. And this is actually very nearby the place I'm living right now. I not always lived in Brasilia, but now I'm living there, and there are some people doing a very good job in terms of producing and profiting from agroforestry produce. So I'm gonna just give a pause on this this presentation. And so, yeah, go chop.
Do they put the trunks of the trees by the size of the
Oh yeah, so they try to limit the places where the plants are grown, and sometimes they put the barks, the pieces of wood, so they can walk there, because some of these areas get, like yours, very wet. So in that way, you're doing two things. You've been able to walk there nicely and not getting wet, but you also, after these pieces of wood decompose, is always going to be incorporated in the system. So the you basically feeding the bacteria and the fungi, improving your soil conditions. But it's also to limit, to concentrate the nutrients around the plants, to make the very same beds that you're also doing in your farm. So yeah, good question. Let's see if we can play this. I'm not a very technological person. I think I'll just close it. See, yeah. So this is what, so we have like English subtitles. Everyone here can deal with that. So if not, we can just stop and talk about along the way, but it's a very straightforward documentary, and I think it's worth it seeing about how we people are doing this agroforestry activities in Brazil. I think. It takes a while because my computer is getting like me, old, and you know, old people try to be more slow, think more about life, so it takes a while. And there we go. This is the guy that conducts the course I took with my student in the center of Brazil, João. You can see the soil is always covered by vegetation. So this is very close to Brasilia.
Situação anterior a esse sistema. Era um capim antropólogo.
um sistema de acumulação inicial. Nas primeiros plantios, quando a gente pega a terra do zero, que as terras aqui são 10, 15 anos abandonadas e não cresce nada, né? Só o capim que fica dominando, a vegetação não consegue mais vir porque o sistema.
Can you guys all follow like what's going on? Yeah?
Então, no início, a gente faz uma adubação semelhante à adubação da agricultura orgânica de alta escala. E aí, na sequência, quando a gente vai refazer as hortas, eu já começo, cada vez que eu faço uma horta nova, a gente já coloca bem menos. Pó de rocha já não entra nunca mais, que é a correção do solo e a mineração, remineração, a gente só coloca uma vez. No momento que eu colho aqui, o solo vai estar melhor que ele estava antes. Então esse é o nosso grande diferencial, que aí com 2 anos, 3 anos, a gente já começa a ver a diferença de que não precisa mais repetir aquela adubação pesada. A água, cada vez eu uso menos, porque o solo está acumulando água. O tratorzinho, na hora que ele vai passar para fazer o canteiro de novo, ele não precisa mais fazer tanta força, porque a terra está tão fofa, que é só ele passar com a marcha leve que ele já... Você gasta menos o tratorzinho, porque a terra não está compactada, porque a chuva não compacta a terra, e a seca não deixa a terra seca. Né? Então, tudo, cada vez que a gente vai trabalhar, a gente está otimizando. Aquele capim de terra ácida, ele não entra aqui mais. Você pode plantar ele aqui, que ele não vai mais. E é isso que o Ernest se refere quando ele fala em agricultura de processos e não agricultura de insumos. Não tem nada de dogmático. No caso deles,
this is the manioc.
Mas a diferença é que trabalhando desse jeito, em favor desse processo de vida, o cenário vai mudando, o ambiente vai melhorando progressivamente. Então o que a gente vê aqui é o exemplo de uma ação antrópica que tem um resultado mais benéfico.
This is all wood chips that they green, they grind and spread along the soil to accelerate the whole process. That's all eucalyptus that they trim and grind. That's the machine that transformed the wood into wood chips. That's what they do with the banana branches. Exactly. Yeah, and that's why that's a big difference between the system that they devised, because they need to find a species that they also want the timber in the future. So you see that they're not cutting the whole thing. He always climbing the ladder and cutting above 6 meters, 5 or 6 meters, because that whenever he prune, all that material is going to be grinded and incorporated in the soil as a source of carbon mostly, but also whatever other nutrients that that material has. But he's preserving also the timber. So the timber is growing. It's growing in size and in the diameter. And that also is going to be sold in the future, after 3 years, for example. And that's a lot of money that entering the system, for example, to buy new equipment. Or maybe he needs that, that wood to build fences or houses. Or so it's a very intensive, and you as a farmer can understand, can already envision that it's a lot of work, right? Intensive, all the time, like pruning and transforming this material in fertilizer, right? And here you can see like clearly the succession, right? All the vegetables here, and then all the medium, like middle age system here with bananas, and here already with the eucalyptus. And he tries to do that in every parcel he opened, or he transformed, removing that grass, that very acidic soil grass that he showed in the beginning. Yeah. So I'm going to move forward a little bit, because now they're going to talk about, oh, the research institutions are coming here to understand the system and try to make some measurements of how what this means in terms of profit or, you know, all these technicalities. But and there are some more interesting parts in the future here. Yes. Yeah, this guy is the president of the extension agency in Brazil. He's very, he's putting forward the idea of taking his extensionists to this area so they can learn and go to the peasants' properties and try to disseminate these technologies. So, but this is an important part. So how they sell this this production, their production. She was my professor in the university, Suzy. So this idea, this last idea of AIP is like, it is a critique of him, by him, of the Brazilian conservation system, because in Brazil we have some areas that are called areas of permanent protection, and he always criticized this and said you shouldn't be protecting these areas against people, you should be incorporating people in these areas so they could, you know, that we talked before, like, understand, like, and preserve that area, produce food in that area without destroying it. So it's a, he's a very critical of this whole way Brazil protect the environment. So I'm trying to move forward to the point we stopped. So this is a second, oh, it's already there, good. This is a second technique that people are using in Brazil. Very little still very infant, but it's called aquaponics. And I know that at least in the past, I don't know how it's happening here now, but it's this idea of combine animal production with vegetable production. I remember a long time ago, we had this agricultural program, TV show in Brazil that shows what's going on in agriculture around the world. And there is a moment they show, like, in the China land, where people plant rice in some place where they plant rice, they're also gonna raise fish and ducks, or right? So that is the kind of idea of complementary enterprises that people are trying to put forward in Brazil. But I would like to show you the size of the, but basically what's happening is what nature does. So whenever the fish are incorporated in the system, their excrements like feces and urine can be converted from ammonia into more usable minerals by nutrients by the plants, like the nitrate. So one group of bacteria is going to convert ammonia in nitrates, and another group of bacteria are going to convert nitrate in another nitrogenous compost. I don't know the name of this right now. And then the plants can use again that nitrogen-based nutrient and filter these nutrients from water, and the water goes back to the fish tank already free of this that what could be toxic, because ammonia in a large concentration can be very toxic. That's why some people put filters in the aquariums, mostly because of the ammonia that accumulates there. So that ammonia is going to be converted by the bacteria into usable forms of fertilizers taken by the plants, and then the water can be returned to the tank where the fish are already filtered. And the whole system, the aquaponic system, can be set up in a very nice way like this. But people are adapting this to different systems, including like filtering part of the water because they want to remove part of the sediments. And there is a place in Brasilia, if some of you go there, visit me, I'm going to take you guys there to see. People use these structures that are very common in Brazil now called iron cement structure, which basically means you build like a cage using iron structures and wire mesh, like the ones you use to prevent chickens or birds to get out of the cage. You build a whole structure using cement and this, so you can use just a very thin layer of cement, so you save a lot of money because you don't need to put a lot of cement there, because the metal structure is going to hold the whole tank in the place. So that's the final result that you achieve using this kind of technology. And these tanks are actually collecting water from the ceilings of the people's houses. So the water is accumulating here, and they put in the fish here, mostly tilapia, because tilapia is very resistant to every condition of poor food feeding or low oxygen, you know, dirt water. So they basically raising tilapia here. But what they realized, and that's a big change in this system, was that if we raise this kind of aquatic plant that I just noticed have invaded Hong Kong. This is from Brazil, Acornia. But I saw it here, so I was like, someone did this. Someone brought this. They're very invasive, they're very powerful. But one good thing when you combine this kind of plant with tilapia is that on the roots of these plants, several microorganisms grow, they flourish, they like it, because these plants are recycling a lot of the nutrients in the water at the level of the roots. So the microorganisms start to accumulate around the roots, and those microorganisms feed, for example, micro crustaceans like little shrimps or little invertebrates, like really tiny. And the tilapia then can eat that those kind of organisms, like the micro crustaceans. What that does is that save you money, because instead of providing only fish feed, you can save part of that money, because they're going to take their own natural food from this micro community growing up around the roots. Many farmers in Asia are actually doing this in large scale. I know that in Malaysia they do this raising shrimp. So I don't know if you know what's going on here. Here's the tank. This white structure here is the tank. There's a lot of water here, and each plate of this is like a floating tray where you put the whatever vegetable you want to grow, and the roots are down here in contact with water. And the shrimp or fish or whatever you're raising is inside this tank, like below these plates here. So the excrements of the fish, mostly nitrogen excrements, are feeding the roots of the plane, or the fish or the shrimp, doesn't matter. So then you have, in a very small space, the production of animal protein and vegetable protein. So it's a way to stack your so here's more clear. So these tanks are full of water, and these plants are floating on the water. But inside the water is the animals that you're raising, the aquatic animals you're raising for food. So this has been done in several different scales, like in very artisanal ways as well. And doesn't mean you need, if you're a family of three or four people, you don't need that whole equipment to do that. You can do like this. You cut those barrels in two. Here's going to, you're going to produce the vegetables, and here you can raise the fish and make a little, use a little pump just to make this water circulate around this. So I think it's a very ingenious technology that anyone interested in producing its own food or part of the food can be doing in its own place. So this is about food production. People are also trying to adapt, and this, I have very little experience on that. Right now, we are building our houses in Brazil, in the farm, and that's our idea, to treat our water from shower, for example. If we're not going to use part of it in the flush, to flush the toilets, we're going to be filtering this water in a way that we can reuse this water, for example, to produce fish and plants, right? So this water, after you have a shower, passes through a series of filtering using some organisms that can filter, mostly the microorganisms that grow here, but also the roots of the plants that can evaporate part of this water and filter it. And after it's partially filtered, you can use this water again to raise whatever kind of organisms you're interested on, like aquatic plants or birds and aquatic birds and fish, and even to wet your plants, the plants of your garden or the plants of the plants you're gonna eat, or ornamental plants. So it's another kind of technology that we're. So this was the work of a student of mine. He was trying to create advertising material, like folders, so we could provide the peasants. Because in these rural areas, there are two major problems about water. One of them is get water enough and clean enough so you can use. And the other is with the residues that you produce on your house, like washing your clothes or taking shower or flushing the toilets. So he was going to organize this material on different water treatment systems, so he could provide the peasants information so they could build together all this. And he's a very skillful guy in terms of making drawings. I'm a total disaster on drawing things. So he said, "Oh, I don't know how to do this thing, but I know how to draw." I said, "Well, let's take your skills and just make this advertising things together." This is one technology. In the previous farm where I lived and worked, what you guys seen here, I don't know if you're familiar with this kind of technology, is a way to treat the toilet residues. So this garden, we call the banana garden, it's above, I think I have the scheme here. Yeah, so if we cut this here and see what's going on, like all the way from the top to bottom, we're gonna see this. So basically what we did here was that we used cement to close this air to prevent water of going out of these walls, and we put some bricks here in a kind of pyramid way. These bricks have holes, like on this side as well. We fill this area here with garbage of construction, like pieces of cement and pieces of bricks, all this porous, very, very porous material. Here we put some vegetable, like the coconut shells. We fill this area with the coconut shells, and here we put soil. And then you plant banana or taro or any other plant that have big leaves. Plants that have big leaves means that they're gonna to capture water with the roots and release this water through the leaves in a large amount to the atmosphere. So that's the kind of plant we need there. So we thought, well, we might as well be producing bananas with our toilet waste, right? So the basic rationale of the thing is that the water that arrives here from, this is another way to do using like tires, like old automobile tires. So basically the water with the sewage is arriving here with all the human toilet residues. This wet material is concentrating here, and the banana roots are going to reach this area here, right? Because the material is porous, so the roots can reach, remove all the liquid and evaporate this water through their leaves. And also at the same time using all this natural fertilizer from the area, while the bacteria, that the anaerobic bacteria that doesn't like oxygen, is concentrating here and recycling all these wastes, all these residues. So after a while, the solid residues, like the feces, are going to become really a small amount of the whole system, like 0.03%, because most of it is water, and the water is going to be taken care of by the banana leaves. But all the nutrients are going to be used to produce bananas, and you can eat this banana with no not being concerned about. So this is a way. This is something that we promoted 3 years ago with the support of the Brazilian Army. They have this project called Rondon Project. It's a big project that go to the countryside and try to help the peasants to do something that they really want. And we be in contact with this community in the countryside of Bahia State. And they really, every time they talk to us, they say like, oh, we really need a sewage system in our city, because the sewage making, you know, this, all these things goes like to the soil or reach sometimes the river or the ponds, and the kids are getting sick. We need to deal with that. But would it be impossible for a small city to have a sewage system that really worked well? And I think this is the truth for most of the countryside areas, wherever you go. So we proposed the army to use the money they have and the personnel they have, right? You know, you see, all these guys are just there eating the food that we are paying for, and there is no war, there is no protection that they can provide. They're doing basically nothing. We're feeding them. So why not put these guys to work for the population, right? So we proposed this project, got some guys that would be able to work on the construction parts. I can see our friend here would be a big help if that happened in China, this skillful construction man. So, anyways, so we went to this countryside, to this little city, and we moved from small farm to small farm, building this kind of structure, using the villagers also to, so they could get they could learn the whole technology. So in the future, they could replicate this technology to their kids' land or to neighbors or to whoever had the interest on that. And they're so grateful. They're so nice to us because we did that. And they treated us so well there. We felt something that we accomplished. Every time I feel accomplished about something, I think about this, because that was very passionate project that we put forward and worked. And even the army guys, the soldiers, are like, we should be doing this. We stay there in the quartels all the time, like just doing push-ups and training. We should be working for the population. They feel so grateful to us, and we need this kind of feeling, like this feedback from the population. So that was something really cool. I think I talk a lot, so I don't want to bother you guys with all this. So I finished this with this. This is a very nice plant from the center of Brazil. It's called Always Alive, Sempre Viva. It's endemic to the Cerrado areas. Indigenous people used to use this plant to do art crafts. And you're going to be able to see when you go to visit me in Brazil, several of the fields that they are now being planting this this flower, and is actually the symbol of the Cerrado. So thank you very much for your attention, and whatever question you have, we can. I want to make this material available to you, so I think Dr. Lau can help me to share this material, because I think it's hard for with my bad English and with this some slides in Portuguese. You may need some more time to get the details of the things. I'm also available until the December 8th. 8th is the day, maybe the December 7th, the day I travel back to Brazil, to talk to any of you. If you want to contact me, we can sit, talk specifically about each of these initiatives. Few of them I'm having a hands-on. I'm really working on it. Some of them I just heard and saw people doing, so I thought it was nice to bring to you and just to give you a whole idea of what's happening in Brazil that could be used by peasants, I guess, anywhere in the world where, you know, the power and the structure doesn't reach. So I think we have this role of improving people's lives, and we should be doing that. So thank you very much.
Questions. I'm very interested in the practice of the agroforestry.
Agroforestry? Uh-huh.
And because you see the size of the land is plot is very small,
yeah,
in Hong Kong. So I'm just wondering, what is the like minimal size of that kind of practice to make it possible? And the second question is, do the people working with this principle, they're anticipating that their land would become like a big fruit forest maybe in 10 or 20 years.
Uh-huh.
What I'm trying to think is, do people still keep growing vegetables while keeping the whole forest, like maybe 10 or 20 years later?
Yeah, good question. So, two things. Any scale, you can do a agroforestry in any scale that you want. Of course, you need to have some space, for example, for the tree grow, but it doesn't need to be a forest. It can be just two or three trees, fruiting trees, for example. But it's obvious that in that scale, you're not going to profit from it. But you can just, if your goal, for example, in your backyard is to have trees producing fruit for you, you don't need to only plant the fruits there and wait this fruit to grow and leave that small piece of land, just resting. So you can be planting lettuce or arugula or carrots or beets or tomatoes. You can plant all this while your trees are growing, and after your trees reach a certain size that's going to be shading all that area, that's again up to you if you're going to prune the branches to allow some sun get in, some light to get in, because you want to. Your goal could be, I want to reserve at least this piece so I can have lettuce or carrots like every week. Or you're going to just be happy with your initial goal, which was to produce fruits, and you'll be happy with the 3 years that you planted vegetables continuously. And that can happen in any scale. To be profitable, then you need to have more land, right? Because exactly about the conversation we always have with the peasants when we get there and say, look, how much food you need per week to sustain your family? So based on that, so how much carrot, how much lettuce, how much tomato, for example, you would use to sustain your family for a week? Once you have that answered, more or less, you can plan for the whole year, because these things also are good. We always try to respect the seasonality of these plants, right? Some plants are, they do well during some time of the year, but during other parts of the year they don't. So that's another thing we need to pay attention, that we need to re-educate ourselves to accept nature cycles. If you wanna eat tomato the whole year, that means part of your tomato, if you're not living in the tropics, for example, is going to come from a very distant area. And what that means is that you actually eating a lot of petroleum, because your ecological footprint encompasses the transportation, the fertilization, the pesticides, and all the oil-based inputs that you need to use to keep the tomato producing the whole year. So we need also to have this in mind, that nature has cycles, as we have. The nature also has cycles, the plants have cycles. So if you wanna do in the right way and you want to profit, it's one scale. If you only want that to sustain your family, that can be a much lower scale. And again, it depends on how the citizens, mostly on the cities, are educated to see and to act actively towards food. Because if people want to eat nice food and want to pay a really cheap price for food, that means you're gonna need a lot of space to produce enough food so you can survive selling that food. But if people are mindful of what the whole process of producing healthy food really means, they're gonna be able to pay you more. They're gonna be willing to pay you more. They go there, visit you, have the amazing experience I had yesterday, and they're gonna say, oh, that guy deserves so much more than I would pay for a conventional tomato. Because the money that you save buying a cheap, industrially produced tomato, you're gonna pay in a few years in the doctor. Because you're accumulating all these pesticides inside you, and tomato is a big issue in terms of pesticide, like bell peppers and a lot of the leaf vegetables as well. Mostly in Brazil, I don't know here, strawberries and all this. There are some major problems there. So why should I be saving this money just to spend later on the doctor? So these kind of things take time for people to develop, for people to understand. But if people are willing to pay you a little more like a fair price for your densely nutritional produce, you can have like a smaller area giving you the same profit that you need to sustain your family, for example. So that it's a multifaceted problem, or I shouldn't say problem, but solution, that takes time for people to incorporate. I had this this very nice example. I was going to show you another presentation about the way this guy in US, in this farm called Polyface Farm, produce food. You know about him, Joel Salati?
Yeah,
I can show you some images soon. I was there for 15 days. I spent 2 weeks there. I read a book by Michael Pollan called The Omnivore's Dilemma, and that changed my mind. I said, now I think it's feasible. I go there. And so I called him. He was like, oh, we cannot receive any more interns because we already booked to the next 5 years. I was like, oh. because they want people to go there and spend a whole year to see the seasons and the cycles of nature, to participate in every step. And I tried to explain to him that I was about to leave to Brazil, I was finishing my PhD. It would be really be important for me because I wanna change my goals and go do farming. And 2 weeks later he called me and said, look, there is a guy here, intern, he is leaving 15 days earlier than scheduled. So would you be interested to come and spend these 2 weeks? I said, I'm there tomorrow. I'm traveling already. So next day I took the airplane, went there and spent 15 days. Those 15 days changed my life. But I'm not going to talk about all these 15 days, but there was one event. I was working in the Saturdays, people, the clientele go there and they buy the eggs or chicken or beef or whatever product is available. And there was this lady, she is probably like 50, 55. She arrived there in a convertible Cadillac, brand new, beautiful. And she stopped there and she was a new client. And she introduced herself, told us that she has been introduced to the eggs that he produced by a friend. And she thought that was so amazing that she went there she wanted to become a client. So, and Joe said, oh, sure, great. I just want to know the name of the person who gave you the eggs, because we used to reward people that advertise for us. It's a way to keep people there. So after that, he said, oh yeah, sure, here's a dozen eggs, $3. She was like, what? $3 a dozen? Why should I pay $3 a dozen? The supermarkets were like $1.50. And we were like, that's not gonna end up well, because Joe is he take a very active role in educating his clientele. So he was like, can you go outside? So he embraced her and we went outside. I was just looking because I wouldn't miss that. So he went with her outside and he was like, I can see that you are a person that like, really enjoy nice things and are probably willing to pay a high price for a nice car, for example. Why should it be different with food? The money you save here, you're gonna pay in the doctor in a few years. And I can assure you, I'm producing the best eggs you can buy in 1,000 kilometers from my farm. So it's an option. You opt for a better eggs or for a dollar and a half eggs in the supermarket. And she looked at him, and we all expecting she to react like violently or at least. Actually, I'm gonna take 2 or 3 dozen to my neighbors as well. So, and then he came in and said, look, this is the way we should be educating people, like putting in perspective why a cell phone or a nice car is more worth of paying a high price, and food should be considered like lower class, you know? So that's one thing. But anyways, that was a very open mind example for me. And the other question you made was about the forest grow.
Yeah, like 20 years later.
Oh, 20 years later, yeah. So you can conduct many activities in this kind of with this kind of technology. So after the your forest is established and you have like fruit production, timber production, you can add enterprises into it. Bees is one of them. So in Brazil, you have, for example, not only in Brazil, but in the tropical America, you have several species of what we call native bees, stingless bees, bees that don't have like the sting. And the honey produced by these bees are very highly appreciated by the people living in the cities or even around these rural areas. So this is something that you can add to your system. So you're starting to pile several enterprises in the very same piece of land where you produce already fruit, timber, water, if that's the case, and you're producing now honey as well, or wax, bee wax. So you can deal with several enterprises in the very same spot of land. Of course, the larger the piece of land, you can be managing this piece of land. So you're not happy with that amount of forest, just cut it, and they're gonna regrow again. And while they're regrowing, you're taking your chance and just planting vegetables again. So let the cycle have another spin, you know, run again. And I don't see that. I know many biologists and some conservational people would feel like, oh, cutting the trees? But I mean, when you cut a lettuce, it's not the same thing of cutting a tree in terms of life. Maybe it's much less biomass, but that's a living being, right? So when we capture a fish and kill that fish, why that fish should be less valuable to us than a cow, for example, or a monkey? They are all different forms of life. If you look then in the essence, it's all life, right? But I understand that our minds are prepared to feel more pity, for example, about a little monkey that looks so much alike to us and have the expressions and everything. I know about that. I respect that. But in the end, it's all life, and we need to deal with that. And I think it's a very respectful way to deal with nature without destroying. Actually, it's making that eternal. Because you can be managing that piece of land like for generations, and the soil is always going to be better, more productive. Your kids can be there adding their own enterprises if they want. If you compare this with the way we are producing food right now in a conventional way, I think it's worth a try. We should be trying some of this more nature-based technologies. I think it's but you're right. The scale, it's important. I don't think people can profit from this technology in a small piece of land. Maybe I think you're doing the right thing with the land that you have available to you right now. But if you had, for example, in the slope of that forest, maybe you could just make some clearings and do agroforestry there, and in the open areas you can be planting the way you are right now. So different land requires different analysis and a plan of what I want from this, what I want from this piece of land, what I want from me and for the next generations. So I think, I don't know if I respond well, but that's how I think. Yeah, so...
Stimulate discussion. Do you consider emphasizing or assessing the contribution of agroforestry or global warming?
Yeah,
because you know, I advocate myself. I don't know whether you heard about the Cosmic Protocol about water cycle.
Mm-hmm.
To me, global warming is more about the disruption of water cycle than carbon cycle.
Yes.
Because
yes.
While the mainstream theories that we release too much carbon mm-hmm. into the atmosphere, yeah. that's caused global warming. But according to my belief, it's just a belief or mm. just a belief, according to the Cosmic Protocol,
yeah.
actually water cycle holds a key of the regulation of the global climate. Because of deforestation, because releasing carbon into the atmosphere alone, well, didn't you know contribute much
mm.
than releasing too much water into the atmosphere, because we know that water is a miracle
yeah.
stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
This is the in the whole universe,
yeah,
it got the highest, you know, water heat capacity.
Yeah, yeah.
They mean the same amount of yeah, the mass of water actually hold much more heat than any material in the yeah, universe.
Yeah.
So that's if we compare, you know, the trend of the global warming with the deforestation along the last 200 years, actually they are the same process.
Mm.
So, as you mentioned about it, water and soil are the key elements for the survival of human being or for all the species of this planet. And actually, water and soil are integrated together,
yes,
in a single,
yes,
system.
Yeah,
they are not separated.
That's what I was gonna say. Yeah, yeah.
And you know, a healthy and intact forest habitat or forest system actually is the heat, you know, container for the planet.
Yeah.
So that's why Amazon forest is so important.
Yes,
it's not
yes,
just about, you know, the
definitely,
because well, the yeah, forest which we will capture all this, will retain all this water, the moisture,
yes,
into the soil,
yeah,
which will contain a lot of heat into
yes,
the soil.
Yes, yes.
The reason that's why the use of industrial agriculture is destroying
yeah,
the environment or contributing to the global warming is, as you say,
yeah,
all the soil actually is spoiled,
yeah,
exposed
yeah,
to the air. That's why so much water is released into
yes,
the atmosphere. That's why the whole water cycle is disrupted
yes,
in a certain sense.
Yes.
So I'm not sure, because I'm not expert in this field. I'm wondering, maybe you can do some assessment or do some, you know, scientific research into how much actually the practice of agroforestry will contribute to the, you know, to the, you know, to the betterment or to the improvement of global warming,
yes,
by creating a micro system.
Yes.
Because a micro system, we all know that a forest will create a micro system that will affect the micro, what I call the micro climate.
Climate, yes.
In the system. And all this micro climate accumulate together,
yes,
will have a huge impact on
yeah,
the,
yeah,
the global
broader scale,
global
yeah,
scale, you know, the,
yeah,
the global climate
at, yeah,
the whole scale. So I really believe that, you know, the practice of this
yes,
small scale
yes,
agroforest actually contributes much to the micro climate, the
yes,
improvement of the micro climate. We all know that the forest will attract water.
Yes.
With the deforestation, all the land or the air will become, you know, heating,
yeah,
become, you know, hotter and hotter.
Yeah.
So I really
definitely
believe that the contribution of this small scale agroforest contributes, you know, contributes much more than providing food.
Yes.
But also
oh, yeah,
for improving the,
yeah,
the microclimate, which
yeah,
together should be one of the key
yes,
solution of the global warming.
Yeah. Definitely.
Can you talk about this?
I think you're absolutely right. And we're talking here about what in ecology we call externalities.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes people don't aim to improve global climate, but their actions could be making it worse or making it better. I also believe that the agroforestry practices, it's going to help to improve the climate as well, mostly through these two cycles, the carbon and the water.
Yeah, exactly.
I think they walk hand by hand, they're kind of part of the same system.
Yes, exactly.
And one interesting data about this specifically is that I have other videos here showing the work of Ernest Goetsch in the southern of Bahia, but one of them is showing that the area surrounding and the proper area that he owns in southern of Bahia is raining more there.
Exactly. Yeah,
right? He's producing rain. He's making the whole thing rain because his forest is so active. And some of his trees are like 50 meters
mm-hmm,
tall. And he has such a... one important thing about the stratification in the forest, meaning the different levels of the forest being respected, a mature forest is going to be forest very well structured is that many different species with different root system can reach water in different depths. So a big tree, if the root is pivotant, like going right down instead of spreading, is going to reach a lot of water from the underground. And that water, that tree works just as a pump, some of them producing, releasing in the atmosphere more than 400 liters a day of water, like in the condensed form, in the form of vapor. So people already noticed that after all these years working on that little, not little, but the 200 hectares in southern of Bahia, he made that region become more wet because it's raining more there. So there are two factors that interact. The springs that usually were born in that area came back after he started to work on agroforest, and that he's producing more rain, and this rain is falling in the ground, like in the higher ground, is going to be filtered and going to feed those springs again. So the guy is basically producing water, and you're absolutely right in terms of the if we had a million Ernest Goetsch working around, some Chinese Ernest Goetsch, some more Brazilian Ernest Goetsch, some American Ernest Goetsch doing the same thing in whatever scale they're doing, we're going to have an impact that's broader than just local. We did that in the opposite direction with global warming. So every enterprise producing one or two kinds of disequilibrium, locally at first, but now globally. And I believe that we can do the other way around. We can have different enterprises in different scales happening everywhere and causing the reversal of all this climate impact. There are some studies that say that if we use only the grasslands already available in the world in a proper way, one of them is the way I showed you guys in the first my first seminar in the science unit, we could come back from this almost chaotic climate to a pre-industrial revolution weather, climate. So, and it would only take about 15 to 20% of this land well managed to do that. So it requires some effort, but first of all, what's required from us is this change of the paradigm. This we should change our monoculture of mind to a polyculture of mind. We should be thinking about several different ways we can address the same problem, and in that way we stack solutions to the same problem, and then we can have a larger scale impact in whatever we do. But all these solutions are, I have no doubt, they are ecologically based, right? We need to go back and respect the cycles of nature so we can have the at least some hope of going back. Yeah, but you're definitely right. Yeah.
Could you say something about agroecology as a discipline, as a kind of, and what sort of impacts it has?
Yes, sure. Agroecology? Yeah, so agroecology is a discipline that is being put together by several different movements that deal with ecological agriculture. In many different places, people are going to produce food under a ecological basis and give this system a different name. Organic agriculture is one of them. Natural agriculture or do-nothing agriculture was created in Japan by Fukuoka. Anyways, the way of producing food in an ecological way is receiving different names everywhere. Agroecology just put many techniques and ideas together and organized in scientific way, in a way that we can understand the causes and the consequences of certain techniques of ecological based agriculture. And whenever I hear someone say, "Oh, you should pay more for this broccoli because it's organic," that's not enough for me right now, because I'm more requiring in terms of information. It is organic in what sense? People just didn't use pesticides. Okay, that's good for my health. But if they just replace the chemical pesticide for a natural pesticide, like using neem extracts to produce it, but they treat their laborers, like their workers, really bad, or they treated the land in the very same way they do in a conventional agriculture, like bare land. For me, that doesn't sound like a sustainable. That's just organic. Okay, it would be better for my health than conventional broccoli, but we should be searching for something more. We should be searching for sustainability. And that's what I think agroecology can contribute. In California, we have, I saw there in San Joaquin Valley, there are some huge trace of land being producing organic food, organic vegetables. But it's a kind of organic production that only replace the inputs, replace the fertilizers or the pesticides. But their minds and the way they conduct, it's not good for the environment. Maybe a little better. It's not good for the workers. And in the end, it's not good for the whole system, because you have this elite of farmers concentrating land and asking for a huge price for a produce that is not environmentally sound, is not environmentally healthy. So I would trade that for what Chow is doing right now, because I think that's more ecologically sound, socially sound, and why not economically sound, because his work is about community, is about changing people's lives. In a conventional, what we call, I get you read the book, The Omnivore's Dilemma, Joel Salatin called big organic. You didn't change your mentality. You're still a very imperialist person trying to concentrate money and land. But now you know that organics is the trend. So you're gonna just invest on producing organic. That might be better for the health of the people that are already rich and can pay a high price for that organic food. But how much did you change in a larger scale? You know, you're just concentrating good food among wealth people. That's not fair. That's not the way the organic food should be contributing for improving the life in the planet. So I always tell people that I don't wish to produce organic anything. I like to produce sustainably whatever I'm going to produce, because that I'm thinking about the people around me, my community. I'm thinking about the environment that's surrounding me, and I'm thinking also about my banking account. That shouldn't be demonized. I don't think that it's all, you know, I don't need to become an against money person to be able to be successful using the ecological ideas to produce food. So I think that's the big contribution for that agroecology can bring to, mostly to the peasants, but that can be applied to any scale or to any size of company. Because if your land is limited, you're already limited in terms of what you can produce there and still make a profit. You're not going to be planting soybeans in 5 hectares or 2 hectares, but you might succeed in terms of keeping your family on the wheels if you produce vegetables. And if you produce those vegetables in a more sustainable way, you can reach a higher price in the market and you can profit a little more. And that's just fair. That's not, you know. So I think you can imagine producing vegetables and chickens and eggs and milk in a little parcel like 4 hectares, that's my plan in Brazil. Being successful in all these venues, like the social, the economic, and the environmental way. And I guess that's the big contribution of agroecology, mostly for the peasants and for the peasant movements. And I'm very happy to say that it's happening in Brazil right now. Not only Brazil, whole Latin America, as far as I know. And the way the peasants are seeing their possibilities right now is always connected to, it's mostly connected to agroecology, because they don't want their kids to be dealing with pesticides. They want their produce to be better paid, and they don't want to destroy the very same soil they depend on. So I think that those are the major contributions agroecology can give to the peasants and to the social movements that try to reform land in Brazil or wherever developing country, India or China. Or, yeah.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
So maybe we will stop here.
Sure.
And let's thank
Jose
again.
Well, it was my pleasure. Great. Thank you.